Assalamu alaikum. Good afternoon, everybody who's present here. I would love to invite each and every person here to the sixth session of the prophetical times, the end studies regarding Bible prophecies and what Bible speaks about end days. You know, 6 weeks, this is the sixth week, you know, time has just flown up. So in the last five weeks, 4 weeks were taken up by Daniel. We understood, we had set a base with respect to what is going to happen in the future times through Prophet Daniel's eye lens. And in the fifth study, we understood there is coming up a war which is imminent, which we can't stop. And that war is going to come up. The name of that war is clearly written in Ezekiel 38 and 39. And we deciphered, unearthed the mysteries in Gog Magog in Ezekiel 38, 39 in the form of Gog and Magog war. Now, moving ahead, there are specific prophecies. Let me tell you something about, you know, we humans. There are certain things with the help of Holy Spirit. Of course, we understand that, yes, this is a fact and we can nail it through. Okay, this is going to happen. This will happen. That will happen, right? But let me be honest, very, very honest here. There are certain passages in Bible which, you know, we cannot fully decipher out. It looks like a probability. I mean, not a probability in air, but a probability which can occur at any point of a time, but we won't be so sure of it. What would be the timelines, right? But with the help of Holy Spirit, can we decipher out? Can we unearth those very important things? Yes, we can. So this is one such study which seems to be a probable imminent prophecy which will happen, which will set the stage for Gog and Magog war. And then further onwards. So something is going to happen, which, you know, which Gog and Magog will notice, right? And that is going to set the stage for this Gog-Magog war. And what is that? But that is exactly we are going to try to understand here. So that's why, you know, in my teaser messages, you would have seen, this can be a probable imminent prelude to Gog and Magog war. With me? So this is, this session, Psalms 83, a decisive hidden prophecy. This is the sixth session on biblical end times. So this is the second session, I would say, of Magog invasion. Maybe an alternative view here. In the first session, we reviewed Ezekiel 38, 39 to know deeply those primary insights that gave fascination to so many of us, known as the Gog and Magog War. So it may surprise you that when you read Bible and match history and science, your views may change from time to time, but it may surprise you that there are those certain things which we have failed to examine carefully enough. And this session is the one such session we'll carefully examine those things. So there's a possibility out there that there is a prelude event that precedes the invasion of Ezekiel 38, 39. Okay, so it may appear a bit strange, but I'm calling Psalms 83, the inner circle war, as prelude, a possible one, which sets the stage for the Gog and Magog war. Let me tell you something here before I start off. On the next screen, as you may recall, this is what we discussed in the last session, you know, on the screens. Can you guys see the screen? Is it visible?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, it is.
Thank you. So if you see, Israel as a tiny nation has been attacked by, you know, Gomer, Magog, Meshach, Tubal, Togarma, Phut, Libya, Cush, right? And of course, Persia. So we understood in the last session what these weird names are, which are the exact locations from where these attacks would happen, right? So I would call this as an outer circle wherein, you know, what do I mean by outer circle? Carefully listen to this. Israel has been attacked by people or nations or locations which are thousands of kilometers apart. My basic question is, where are those immediate neighbors? I understand that, you know, Magog, we understood, can be Russia, Togarma, Meshach, Tubal can be Turkey, Iran, of course, Persia, you know, Iran is an arch rival of Israel. I understand all these things. Iran can attack. But what about the Palestinians, the so-called Palestinians, the Jordanians, the Syrians? Why are they not attacking? Why are the outer circle, you know, the kind of outer circle attacking? So I've been always advocating on one fact, you know, when you find this bits and pieces, you know, this doubting bits and pieces, dig deep, you'll find a treasure over there. So as you may recall, you know, these are those ancient tribal names of a far-flung group of allies that organized themselves to take spoil and invade Israel. And on the screens, Sheba and Dedan strangely sides out. Sheba and Dedan, we understood possible chances, you know, it's Saudi Arabia. They strangely side out. They don't side with the invading party, right? But what about the immediate neighbors? Why are they not seen in Ezekiel 38 and 39? Very strange. If you remember, PLO, the Palestinian Liberation Organization headed by Yasser Arafat, they want Israel to be wiped off from the map of earth. And strangely, Ezekiel 38, 39 is not talking about them. Philistines were existing long time back. So let's see what is in store for us today. What kind of a secret is in store for us today? So these are some preparatory steps. You know, we understand that there is a Israeli-Arab conflict going around since past 70, 80 years. You know, so we understand that Iran is, of course, you know, they vouch for nuclear programs. They are on the verge of becoming a nuclear power, which actually Israel, with the help of IDF and Mossad, exposed to the entire world what Iran is doing. So that's why it is on a halt right now. Now, with the current oil discoveries near Russia, Russia is hungry for power. We understood that, you know, it could be the next war or the next space of war could be over energy. Right. So it's also the energy related politics you can see across the world. Now with ISIS ISIS coming in the picture, it caused a ruckus in Syria and Iraq. How come? From where this small group came up? I request your phones to be on mute. Somebody's phone is not on mute. I request it to be on mute. Thank you. There's an oil gas discovery near Israel that's known as a Leviathan gas field. You know, Israel also has come up with its own sources of energy resources. I request you to be on mute. Somebody's phone is not on mute. Please be on mute. So all these things, what we see in the newspapers and the current news channels, all these appears as preparatory steps in advance for a big climax. So as my question, you know, it sticks out there. Why there is no mention of the immediate neighbors of Israel? So where are the immediate neighbors of Israel in Gog and Magog war? Now, this is a primary question which had come up. So in this session, we'll understand why Ezekiel 38 and 39 has not named the immediate neighbors and why immediate neighbors have actually vanished off from the scene. Let's find out. So these are those missing nations from Ezekiel 38 and 39 on the screens, guys. Palestinians, Lebanese, the Syrians, the Iraqis. Iraqis wouldn't be they are not an immediate neighbor, but an extended neighbor. The Jordanians, the Egyptians. Strangely, these people are missing from the scene. And let me tell you something about them. These are major players existing in the Middle East today. You know, the Syrians, Iraqis were major players. Egypt is a major player. Palestine has come up with the help of Hezbollah and Hamas. They're a major player existing right now in Middle East. So these are the immediate neighbors and extended neighbors of Israel today. Where are they? You know, they're not to be seen. So we are here in the study, we are actually looking at a strange omittance. Why this omittance has come up? Right? And to these nations, I would link one statement which you would have seen in the first slide. Their God changes the pathway of our rockets in midair. Please remember that statement. We'll discuss about that statement in the end. It's quite interesting. Let's move ahead. So there are quite a lot of perquisites for Gog and Magog war. So when you read Ezekiel 38, 39, it was written at a time when Israel was not there, right? So Israel, for this prophecy to be fulfilled for Gog and Magog, Israel had to come back, which it came back as a prophecy. You know, it came back on May 14th, 1948 at 4 p.m. It has to be militarily secured. It is right now, but not fully. So Ezekiel 38, 39, we'll revisit those verses. It says, the nation of Israel has to be at peace in the Middle East while Gog and Magog attacks. Really? I don't think so. I don't think so. Nation of Israel is peacefully residing with its residents as of now. It has to be a fully restored nation. Not yet. They're doing well in many, many areas though, like in medical field and scientific fields. You know, they're doing really well, but the nation is not fully restored. There are certain problems which comes up. So are they dwelling in peace? Let's revisit this verse, Ezekiel 38, 8, which says, after many days, you will be called to arms. In future years, you will invade a land that has recovered from war, whose people were gathered from many nations to the mountain of Israel, which had long been desolate. They had been brought out from the nations, and now all of them live in safety. So Ezekiel 38, 8 is stating about Magog and its troops noticing that Israel has recovered from the war. And after many days, you will attack them. You will invade a land that has recovered from war. I really don't think so. Israel has truly recovered from the frequent wars. Then Ezekiel 38, 11 on the screen. You will say, studying what Magog, I will invade a land of unwalled villages. I will attack a peaceful and unsuspecting people, all of them living without walls, without gates and bars. Really? Do you think Israel doesn't have a wall around it right now? I doubt it. Israel has walled up most of its borders with its annoying neighbors. So as of now, it is still a walled village. It is not unwalled yet. So these are certain problems which we see in in Ezekiel, right? So basically what I'm trying to point out here is there is a big difference between Ezekiel 38 and 39 and Psalms 83. There are two wars which will come. One is an outer circle war. One is an inner circle war. Let me explain that to you. Let me just point out to Ezekiel 38 and 39 first. So these are the players, you know, in Ezekiel 38, Russia, Turkey, you know, all those other players, Iran. These are non-bordering nations. But Psalms 83 says these are bordering nations, you know, the neighbors will actually attack. The motivation, if you see on the screen of Psalms of Ezekiel 38 and 39 is spoil and plunder and wealth. They're greedy. So they notice that Israel is secured and they want to plunder it. But the motivation in Psalms 83 is not greediness. The motivation is to wipe off Israel off the map. Right? We'll see. We'll witness all these verses. So I would basically say Ezekiel 38, 39 as an outer circle and Psalms 83 as an inner circle war, wherein both the set of wars, we see a different set of allies going against Israel. Let's move ahead. Before we hit Psalms 83, before we start off, you know, we see this amazing verse in Ezekiel 37, 9, 10. Then he said to me, prophecy to the breath, prophecy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says, come, breathe from the four winds and breathe into this slain. So I prophesied as they commanded and breath entered them. They came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. You know, we had a detailed session on this. It's actually mentioning about Israel coming back on the surface of the earth again, right? A breath of life. It's a symbol of a life-giving spirit of God. So as we read verse 10 on the screens, I want you to notice one thing, an exceedingly great army. That's an important clue here before we enter Psalms 83. Is Israel a great nation as in terms of the military personnels today? They are not. They have a pretty interesting record, Israeli Defense Force and all their intelligence agencies put together. They have a pretty interesting record and they do really well, but they're still very small in number today. I want you to focus on this point, exceedingly great army, a vast army. With me? We may be in for a big surprise now. Why I'm showing these verses, why I'm setting the context, we may be in for a big surprise. I suspect with whole of my heart that including the current Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu and maybe his successors, they have a backbone. they would do something really strange and gutsy. So there's a surprise which is coming up. Is there possibly an overlooked event that precedes the ill-fated Gog and Magog invasion in Ezekiel 38-39? I would say yes, very much. So there's a surprise coming up. So on the screens, guys, if you see, Israel is surrounded by these countries. I'm showing the flag of these nations, Lebanon, Syria, Palestine, Egypt, Jordan, right? Of course, Saudi, you can see over there, but Saudi doesn't side with the attacking party, right? I want all the listeners to explore the book of Psalms. And while you explore that, it's amazing to find how much of the prophecies are anchored in Psalms. So Psalms 83, in particular, maybe a forthcoming scenario most of us would have overlooked, because Psalms looks so simple and so nice to read, we overlook certain things. So let's immediately jump into it. Let me just read out Psalms 83, 1 to 3. O God, do not keep silence. Do not hold your peace or be still, O God. For behold, your enemies make an uproar. Those who hate you have raised their heads. They lay crafty plans against your people. I'll repeat that. They lay crafty plans against your people. They consult together against your treasured ones. Wow. Now, these are just not simple enemies. It's a rather puzzling chapter, I would say. What we see here is that whoever these enemies are, which Psalms 83 is talking about, they hate God, Yehovah, and are daring enough. If you look at the verse 3 carefully, they have taken crafty counsel against whom? Against Israel. Right? Psalms 4 or 5, when we read ahead, it says, they say, come, let us wipe them out as a nation. Let the nation of Israel be remembered no more. Somebody's phone is not on mute. Please put it on mute. The fourth verse says, they say, come, let us wipe them out as a nation. Let the nation of Israel be remembered no more. For they conspire with one accord against you. They have a covenant. So what is this all about? As I said, whoever these enemies are, they hate God and are daring enough, right? So when you look at the fourth and fifth verse carefully, let us wipe Israel out as a nation from the face of earth. Let the nation of Israel be remembered no more. Really? That's the very commitment of Islam, isn't it? To wipe Israel off the map. That's not the commitment of Ezekiel 38 and 39 team of nations. I'll repeat. The fourth verse here is, let's wipe away Israel from the surface of earth. That's the very commitment of Islam. And that's not the commitment of the team which attacks in Ezekiel 38 and 39. The Gog and Magog war comes to take spoil and loot Israel, which is clearly mentioned in 38 and 39 Ezekiel. But Psalms 83, the team of enemies here are coming against Israel with a common purpose. It's hatredness. Wipe away Israel from earth, from the map of the earth. Let me ask you a question here. Does this statement, you know, remind you of somebody? I've always advocated on one fact. I'll show you one video here. It's a news video, live news video, recorded news video, in fact. I've always advocated on one fact. Go back to the news channels. Be vigilant about this general knowledge about what the world is doing and how is it shaping up. You'll come to know that some of the news channels are actually airing news which was written 2,500 years back. Wipe Israel off the map. Let me show you something, the very verses, the very words. It's on the screens, you'll be seeing Mahmoud Ahmadinejad. He was the ex-prime minister of Iran, Persia, right? Let's see what he's saying.
Taking aim once again at Israel and the United States, Iranian President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad repeated inflammatory comments that he made 3 years ago, saying Israel would soon disappear. Ahmadinejad first made the remarks in 2005, fueling international outrage and speculation that he was threatening the Jewish state with a nuclear weapon. But while speaking at a ceremony honoring the late founder of Iran's Islamic Republic, Ahmadinejad told an audience that, quote, this origin of corruption will soon be wiped off the earth's face. Ahmadinejad also called...
What did he say? Is the audio, is it audible to all of you?
Yeah, he's also saying the same thing.
Yes, yes. I'll just play it once more.
Face. Ahmadinejad also called the U.S. a satanic power that, with God's will, would be annihilated. On Tuesday, Ahmadinejad arrived in Rome for a U.N. summit designed to help combat skyrocketing food prices worldwide. His attendance at the meeting was denounced by both Jewish leaders and a host of political and activist groups. John Belmont, The Associated Press.
There you go. Mahmoud Ahmadinejad stating those exact verses mentioned in Psalms 83. Let's wipe out Israel from the surface of earth. That's not the immediate neighbor. Or isn't this Persia or Iran isn't a part of Psalms 83 group, but he articulates the same thing. And that's what the neighbors inspire. Now, to be very specific, even Palestine, even Jordanians. Sometime back, they were ranting this to wipe out Israel from the surface of earth. What is happening here? Are we seeing a prophetical time? Are we seeing something getting fulfilled? Let's wait and watch. Let's move ahead. So when you move ahead, you see who are these enemies? You know, Psalms 83, 6 till 8, it says, these enemies are the tents of Edom and the Ishmaelites and the Hagarites. Gebal, Ammon, and Amalek. Philistia with the inhabitants of Tyre. Ashur also has joined them. They are the strong arm of the children of Lot. Selah. Oh, these names. Meshach, Tubal, Togarma. Tents of Edom, Ishmaelites, Moab, Hagarites, Gebal, Ammon. We'll see who they are. The first identity is the tents of Edom, guys. You know, which is highlighted on the screens. Now, this is one important group of all the whole lot of bunch. Because Edom is idiomatically, I believe, is the identity of the traditional enemies of Israel all throughout the history. I suspect that they could be Palestinian refugees and the Jordanians in the current day scenario. But they are included in that group which attacks Israel. So why it is known as tents of Edom? So let me show you some pictures here on the screens. Some of the pictures taken in 1948, the tents of Edom. These are actually the literal Palestinian refugees, which have become a thorn in the flesh of Israel right now. Take a look at the Arab camps since years. They don't just realize these you know, poor refugees, they don't realize that they are just pawns of the Arab politics or the Islam politics since years. Can you believe? They just cannot go back to their own people. I mean, Saudi, Jordanians, Iraqi, the Lebanese, they are not taking back their own people. They are actually told to be there in Israel as refugees. The Arab world is conveniently playing on these refugees by not taking their own people back to their lands and are playing with the sympathies of the world against Israel. The myth known as Palestinian issue is created to create a ruckus for Israel. Which country, you know, there are Indian refugees. India can go to any extent and bring these refugees back. Every country does it. But why are these refugees let alone there? Why are the Arabs not taking back their own refugees? These tents of Edom have become a political instrument for the Arab world since then. Let's move it fast. Who is Philistia? It's the current, on the screens, it's the current Gaza, West Bank, and other ethnic groups. So this is the map of Israel, as you can see on the screen. And those green patches, one small green patch, it's Gaza. Gaza's name has still not changed from the biblical era. And the other green patch is the West Bank. This is the current day Philistines, or what we call as the West Bank and Gaza stretch. So before we proceed further, let me just put a context here. I want to talk about a little bit about an everlasting hatred which started in the womb between Jacob and Esau, and it continues to till this date. It started in Genesis 25. Let's read. This is the account of the family line of Abraham's son Isaac. Isaac was 40 years old when he married Rebekah, daughter of Bethuel the Aramean. Right? 21st verse says, Isaac prayed to God on behalf of his wife because she was childless. And God hears it. God hears it. And on the 23rd verse, which is a highlighted verse here, the Lord said to her, what's that? Two nations are in your womb. The two people from within you will be separated. One people will be stronger than the other, and the older will serve the younger. When the time came for her to give birth, there were twin boys in a womb. Now, this is very crucial, guys. You know, you can miss out these points. Remember this thing, the 25th verse. The first to come out was red, and his whole body was like a hairy garment. So they named him Esau. Why am I emphasizing on this verse? There's a reason, you'll come to know. After this, his brother came out with his hand grasping Esau's heel. So he was named Jacob. Isaac was 60 years old when Rebekah gave birth. The boys grew up. Esau became a skillful hunter, a man of the open country, while Jacob was content to stay at home among the tents. Isaac loved Esau, but Rebekah loved Jacob. The story starts here. What you see in Middle East, the ruckus being created, Israel versus every neighbor of Israel, you know, the story started in Genesis 25. Let me put forth a bit more fascinating points here about Esau. He was on the screens. He was the first twin. The word Esau is loosely connected to the word Seir, one of the early names of Edom. In Hebrew, look at this. In Hebrew, red means Edom, and hairy is similar to Seir. Words were carefully chosen to portray in the child the nature of Edom. So basically, it's a wordplay which is going out here. He was red in color when he was born, Esau, and he was hairy. He was red in color. Remember these statements. Coming to Jacob, he was the second twin on the screens. And we know that Jacob means, it's Yaakov. It means sly, but it also means the person who pulled the heel and came out. Right? So when you see in Romans 9, 11, 13 on the screens, yet before the twins were born or had done things good or bad, in order that God's promise, purpose and election might stand, not by works, but by him who calls, she was told, the older will serve the younger. This is written in New Testament. Just as it is written, Jacob I loved, but Esau I hated. That starts the mystery at the very early stage. So when we read 29th verse onwards, so the boys grew up. One liked hunting, one liked staying at home. So when Esau came from a hunting, after hunting, when he came back one day, he saw Jacob cooking the stew. He said to Jacob in the 30th verse, quick, let me have some of that. What? Red stew. I am famished. Look at the verse. That is why he is called Edom. The meaning red. And the people who represents Edom or Esau and his descendants were also somehow related to the word red. I will show that to you in some time. Jacob replied, first, sell me your birthright. Esau said, look, I'm about to die. I'm hungry. What good is the birthright to me? But Jacob said, swear to me first, selling his birthright to Jacob, you know. Then Jacob gave Esau some bread and some lentil stew. He ate and drank and then got up and left. Look at the last line. That's important. So Esau despised his birthright. How important are the blessings of parents? And how coolly and how not so literally Esau took it. You know, we should learn something from this, guys. Jacob, who inherited those blessings, became Israel and super powerful and super blessed. How important are the blessings of parents? There are many parents in today's modern world, guys, who have been put in old age homes. who have been put as destitutes. The modern day world, you and me, I don't literally mean you and me, I'm telling about the modern world, we don't love parents. How many of us in the modern world go back to the parents and check with them? How many of us, you know, have put our parents in the old age homes? That's why people are losing their blessings. And that's why there are many problems in the personal lives of everybody present on earth. There are small, small lessons which Genesis 25 teaches us. The modern world has forgotten about it. Instead of that, the modern world foolishly, they think they are intelligent. Foolishly, they come up with theories of their own, the stupid theories of the world. You know, let's learn from this incident. Let's be humble, simple. Let's go back to the traditions. Let's get the blessing from our parents. If our parents need us, go back, check with them. Don't despise them. Otherwise, you will be an Esau too one day. Anyways, moving ahead. So the basic point here is Esau offended God. So when you see, you know, that envy came up in Esau after a certain time when he realized, you know, oh my goodness, I lost my blessings and my brother inherited. I want them back. Just imagine that envy started there. But let me tell you, the envy started a long time back. It's a copy paste. Sarah versus Hagar. Isaac versus Ishmael. Jacob versus Esau. Genesis 16, 21, 25, 27. All these chapters show the envy nature which comes up, you know. And not only that, let me show you something else. The bypass of the firstborn is not a new incident in Bible. Seth bypassed Cain on the screens. Shem bypassed Japheth, and from Shem's line came Abraham, and then the blessings. Isaac bypassed Ishmael. Jacob bypassed Esau. Judah bypassed Reuben, Moses, Aaron, and David, the youngest, bypassed all his elder brothers. So this is not a new story if you carefully observe. With me? So let's talk about Edom. There are certain hidden things here. So Edom, as we now know, the name derives, it comes from Esau, you know, the eldest son of Isaac. So basically all the descendants of Esau are known as Edomites, Edom land. So they covered a lot of space, you know, from Red Sea to Dead Sea. It was a lot of space which this entire family of Esau actually covered. And so much so, Esau started hating his own brother Jacob, oblique Israel, so much so that their descendants also practiced the same thing. Just imagine. So Edom, when Israel was coming from Egypt, you know, they refused to let Israel pass through from their own territory. So always across Bible, we have seen this, that always Edomites, the elder brother takes part against Israel. It sides with the Israelites' enemies always. There was a sad event which happened, you know, the Babylonian invasion. It was a sad event where you can see Psalms 137:7. Remember, Lord, what the Edomites did on the screens. On the day Jerusalem fell, what did one brother say about the other brother? Tear it down. Edom, Esau told about Israel. Tear it down. They cried, tear it down to its foundations. Very strange. Very, very strange. You know, this is what Edomites are till now. So we understand that when, you know, after Babylonian captivity, Israel was emptied. Jerusalem was emptied. Who do you think goes in? Who do you think is the prime real estate piece over there? It's Esau and his descendants. That's why they shifted from the current day place from Red Sea to Dead Sea. They shifted towards Israel. They shifted towards Jerusalem. After all, it was both the brothers were tied to the land. Right? Let's move ahead. This is the picture here, guys, of Edom. Can you see on the screens? Edomites. So when Israel was actually emptied, they actually went in. And when they went in, after some time, they developed their own kingdom. That was known as Idumea, or the Edomites / Idumeans. Idumea is a kingdom which was actually set up by Edom, which was set up by Esau's descendants after a long, long time. When Israel got emptied, when Babylon captured Israel, the space was vacant. Edomites moved in and set up a kingdom known as Edomia, which the Greeks called Edomites as Edomites. That is why the Edomia kingdom comes. That is how Edomia kingdom comes up in the picture. Remember this; it'll be useful. Let's move it. So, why am I stating all this on the screens? Why am I stating all this? Why Edomia has to come in the picture? There's a specific reason. So, Bible gives a clear-cut picture of what happened. You know, when Edomites went inside Jerusalem, Israel, they established Hebron as their center and occupied the entire place, right? So on the screens is what Edom was earlier and how Edomia sets up. So why am I saying all this? So when you see Mark 3:8, it's a New Testament verse. We understand that there was a certain place known as Edomia actually. When they heard all he was doing, it was about Jesus. Many people came to him from Judea, Jerusalem, Edomia, look at that, and the regions across the Jordan and around Tyre and Sidon. Strange. Very, very strange. So why am I saying all this? Listen to this very carefully. So when Edomia was in the scene, Israel was not there. But when Israelites came back, later Edomites were conquered by the Jewish armies and were forced to die or flee or forced to convert to a Jew. So while Edomites were really there, they were forced to be converted to a Jew. They don't really become Jews, but they pretend to become one. Why am I telling you all this? Example, there are many in powerful positions in the world today who are Jews, but they are not. They still believe they are Edomites. Let me repeat. There are people in the world who pretend to be Jews, but they are not. And the world also knows them as Jews, but they are really not. They still call them as Edomites. If records are to be believed, how many of you have heard about the Rothschild family? Have you ever heard about this family, Rothschild family? It's a one Jewish powerful family which rules the world. And there are many infamous stories about this family. Right? Listen to this. Rothschild family. The original word is not this. The name is derived from the German word zum Rothenschild. And what does Rothenschild means? It means the red shield, in reference to the house where the family lived for generations. You remember who was red? Esau. Who were red? Edomites. Edomites. This is one such strange record when you try to dig Bible, no? When you try to mix history with it, when you pick information which is relevant, you come to understand there are certain people like this also are existing who are not related to the Jews, but who are Jews to the world. The Rothschild. Their actual name is, from the German root, means Rothenschild. Rothenschild. Rothenschild means red shield, in reference to the house where they lived for many generations. They seem to have an Edomite root. The Edomites are rising up as Jews undetected. I'm sure your minds are working harder now. So many people, including the Romans, you know, when the Romans captured Israel and Jerusalem as a whole, they had a hard time to distinguish these set of people. They thought all are the same, all are Jews, right? So here in Mark 3:8, there is a clear-cut distinction. Jews are different, Edomites are different. You can see the word Edomia over there. The main point which I'm trying to make is that the struggle between Jacob and Esau continue to run till this date. The struggle between Israelites and the Arabs today is nothing but a continuation of the same battle which started in Genesis 25. So while the Romans were renaming the land, when the Romans captured the entire land of Israel, you know, across centuries there were revolts and wars to wipe out Israel by their neighbors. You know, they had a problem. The Romans had a problem. How to name this land right now? Right? So the Roman Empire had two choices in the choice of Israel's two worst enemies, Idumea and Philistia, on the screens. So while Idumeans practiced Judaism too and weren't as arch rivals as that of Philistia, the Romans actually chose to choose the name of Philistia over Idumea for the land of Israel. Because Idumeans confused the Roman Empire, they were more like Jews there. So that is why Romans chose to name the land Philistia, and Idumea got vanished from the maps of the world after this renaming. You with me? So they are a mixed race right now. That's why a lot of confusion has happened. So moving ahead, the tents of Edom and the Ishmaelites, Moab and the Hagarites, Gemal and Ammon, Amalek, Philistia, and the inhabitants of Tyre, Ashur has joined them. They are strong arm of the children of Lot. You know, if you see one more group, Edom we discussed. Ishmaelites, you know what Ishmaelites are, right? We know something about them. So Ishmaelites, who is Ishmael? He came out from Hagar, you know. He was a son of Abraham and Hagar, but he was not the promised son. So that is why Ishmael had an hatred towards Abraham, his father. Ishmael had a hatred towards his brother Isaac too. And from Isaac's line, when Esau and Jacob came on the screens, you can see this. Esau had an hatred towards Isaac and Jacob. And Esau went and married the descendants of Ishmael. The Edomites married with the Ishmaelites. Now, what did that continue? It continued the deep hatredness even more. The Edomites and the Ishmaelites are co-marrying here, you know? So that's why, you know, when you see Israel as a nation, the other groups, the other tribes or the other nations, what you see around that is a co-marrying, is a result of co-marrying. Don't believe the media. See, the media today uses the word Arab very carelessly. Because all of them aren't Arabs. They intermarried and many tribes lost their ethnicity over the years and got commonly termed as Arabs. So what they commonly continued was the hatred towards Israel, their brother, towards the brother Jacob. Right? So look at these names. So Moab, we understand it's Lot's descendants. You know, in the current day scenario, it is Central Jordan and Palestinian refugees. Hagarines. Who are Hagarines? The descendants of Hagar. Mostly Egyptians. I can't say particularly about Gebal, but looks like it is a possible Lebanese. Ammon. If you see, if you further read Psalms 83, you will understand that there is a group known as Ammon, which is current day Northern Jordan and Palestinian refugees. And by the way, the capital of Jordan is still Amman. Amalek. They are south of Israelites. Philistines, you know, it's there like the Palestinian refugees, the current day West Bank and Gaza. What is Tyre? We understood in the previous session, Tyre is nothing but Lebanon. Ashur is what? Syria. And who are the children of Lot? Moab and Ammon, which is current day Jordan. Strange. The original non-Arab Philistines were driven out from Greece around, I'm just giving a brief history here, about 1300 BC. So when they were driven away from Greece, the original Philistines, they unsuccessfully tried to invade Egypt and migrated to the current day Gaza. So ancient Philistia became established on the territory belonging to the tribe of Judah. So here we have all these characters, you know, Moabites, Hagarites, Ammonites, Philistines, Tyre. They have one thing in common. They all have borders with Israel, immediate borders with Israel. And they want Israel out of the map. Right? Let's move ahead. 83, 9 to 18. So do to them as you did to Midian, as to Sisera and Jabin at the river Kishon, who were destroyed at Endor. Make their nobles like Oreb. Oh my God, make them like whirling dust as fire consumes the forest. So may you pursue them with your tempest and terrify them. Fill their faces with shame. Let them be put to shame and dismayed forever. This is what the children of God are saying. That they may know that you alone whose name is the Lord, are the Most High over the earth. So these are few references to the previous victories which Israelites had. It's sort of using history lessons. So Lord gave us victory as you gave us back then. You know, so when you see this, 13 to 16, oh my God, make them like whirling dust, fill their faces with shame. Look at that line, that they may seek your name, O Lord. That they may know that you alone, whose name is the Lord, are the Most High over the earth. What's the point of all this? What do they have common in between them? What do they worship? They worship Allah. They are this is a Muslim force here. Jehovah in contrast to Al-Ilah, the moon god. So what the context is getting set in 9 to 18 is the world will know that God is God. And that's what the psalmist is calling for. Interesting to know that, you know, even Ezekiel 25 to 32 lists these seven groups, Ammon, Moab, Edom, Philistia, Tyre, so on, Egypt. All are Muslims. They all are different tribes. But they all have unity with respect to one thing. They worship Allah. They are Muslims. They all are challenging the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. This is what exactly is happening here. So when you see Ezekiel 28, 25 to 26 on the screens, God, the master, says, when I gather Israel from the people among they have been scattered and put my holiness display among them, then they will live in their own land that I gave them to my servant whom? Jacob. They'll live there in safety. They'll build houses. They'll plant vineyards, living in safety. Meanwhile, I'll bring judgment on all the neighbors. Look at this. All the neighbors who have treated them with such contempt. When we mess around in the Middle East, we are poking our fingers in the eye of God. That land doesn't belong to any Muslim world. That land doesn't belong to the United Nations either. It belongs to the nation of Israel. Look at the last verse. Meanwhile, I'll bring judgment on all the neighbors who have treated them with such contempt, and they will realize that I am God. A war in Middle East is coming up, guys. Watch out for this. Before Gog and Magog, this war will come up. Why? I'll tell you why. Presently, Israel, on the screens, is surrounded by neighbors who wants it wiped off. And they use the same verse, right? It's misleading to call them as Arabs. They are Muslims. So this war of Psalms 83 is a prerequisite victory for Israel, so that it sets the stage for Gog and Magog war. Why this happens, you know? Why this is required? This is required because of the promise which God had given to Abraham. See, the current nation of Israel, you know, if you see the maps, if you see the current day map of Israel, it is not the actual boundary which God gave. Look at the verse. Can somebody read Genesis 15, 18 on the screens a bit loudly? Genesis 15, 18.
Genesis 15, 18. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abraham and said, to your descendants, I give this land from the Wadi of Egypt to the great river, the Euphrates.
Exactly. Man, I mean, you want me to think that God dishonors his own promise? When was the last time this established boundary of Israel was created or established, I would say? That was only during David and Solomon's time. From the Wadi of Egypt to the great river Euphrates. And what is the current map of Israel? It's nowhere near to it. That means Psalms 83 is stating one thing. A war in Middle East is coming wherein Israel will expand its boundaries. That's what it is saying on the screens. The upper picture shows the current map of Israel. The second picture shows more or less, you know, you see that red lines, the red boundaries from the Wadi of Egypt to River Euphrates. My dear son, my dear friend Abraham, I give that to you and your generations. Wow. Has Israel established this boundary after 1948? Not yet. Not even remotely. But when you see from 1948 till 2020, Israel has slowly increased. Now under Benjamin Netanyahu, I'm sure you would have read the newspapers or online news a month or two back, they're planning to take over West Bank fully. Mm-hmm. And the world media is crying because of this. Why is the world crying? I don't understand. This is their land. This is their home. On that day, Lord made a covenant with Abraham and said, to your descendants, I give this land from the Wadi of Egypt to the great river Euphrates. The most important point which I'm trying to make here is don't poke with God's commitment to Israel. If God has said this, this will happen. That means, you know, before 1948, people used to laugh at Israel. No, at Bible itself, Israel is not there. Now Israel came back, 72 years is over. We are entering into the 73rd of year of Israel in another 5 months. Israel is expanding, guys. And if I have to believe this verse literally, that is why Psalms 83 will happen. And when Psalms 83 happens, look at this. When Psalms 83 happens, look at the second picture here, just below the first one. Israel's boundaries will expand like this, from that one portion of red mark to the other portion of red mark, from the Wadi of Egypt to the river Euphrates. And that is why you don't see these people, Jordanians, mostly, most of them will be wiped out. Not the Jordanians as humans, but Jordan as a country. Maybe some part of Jordan, not all. But Lebanon, Syria, Gaza, West Bank, a little part of Egypt, all are in danger. All are in danger. They will be wiped out because Israel is going to take their own land back. And that's when, after the war, when Israel settles down and they are at peace completely, and when their army expands and becomes exceedingly great army, now you understood that verse? It's a vast army. Why will not Russia and Persia notice it? Why will not they notice it? You got the logic here. You got the conjecture. You got the connecting points here. That is why after Psalms 83, you see an expanded boundary. Looks like, I'm not sure, but looks like this only. That is why Ezekiel 38 and 39 doesn't mention some of the arch rivals of Israel. They are not there by the time Gog and Magog comes. Israel is going to expand. And that's when Israel becomes more wealthy, more profitable, more rich, more powerful. And that's why Turkey, Russia, Persia, all these, you know, Gog, Magog, Bet, Togarmah, they will take notice of this and they will try to loot it. And that's why Saudi Arabia comes in the picture and asks, why are you doing this? Are you here to loot? I hope the story is getting clear now. With me? So these are the order of events. This seems to be the order when you read Ezekiel, Jeremiah, and Psalms. First, Israel gathered in the land. Check, it's done. Ancient cities rebuilt and inhabited. Check, it's done. The moment it was done, the Arab world started its resistance. I don't know why, but they failed every time. Israel establishes IDF and other intelligent units like Shin Bet, Aman, Sayeret Matkal, and Mossad. Then the fifth point, adjacent Muslim nations come together. Always they come, you know, because Israel and the military is there. Then the next point, Islam committed to wipe out Israel. We saw this not only in Bible, not only in articles, but through a video. They're making the same commitment to wipe away Israel. Wow. And then the war starts. Then the title is regained, you know. In today's scenario, most Jews don't accept Christ as their Messiah. The title will be regained. Many people will start believing Messiah. And then the promised land to Abraham will finally take its shape. Israel gains territory and becomes an exceedingly great army. The country is reshaped. The border expands. Then they dwell securely without what? Without walls. Now see Ezekiel 38 coming into picture. Israel without walls. This war has to happen to for this point to take place. And that's how Abrahamic covenant gets into effect fully. And that's when Magog notices this and thoughts to invade Israel with its allies, who has recovered from war. Wow. But God, you know, the last point, but God intervenes. And that's how Psalms 83 war takes place, in order to establish the expanded boundary, in order to establish the promise given by God to Abraham. The boundary expands, and then Ezekiel 38-39 takes place, and then God intervenes. That's the series. That's the order of events. I hope you guys are able to understand this order of events, right? Okay. I am not here to sell this idea. I'm here to help all of us to understand, to set aside the pre-held presuppositions which are there in our mind. We have picked up many ideas in the last few years from various study tools, you know, but be careful. Not all study tools reveal the truth. On the screen, 17:11, Acts 17:11, it says, "Now the Berean Jews were of more noble character than those in Thessalonica, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined," what is that? "And examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true." If it happened to Paul at that time, when Paul was saying few things, these Berean Jews went back to Bible and checked if he's saying right or not. I encourage you also to do this. When you hear certain new informations, don't just blindly believe it. Go back to Bible. Go back to the knowledge systems. You know? Check whether this is right or not. And that's how you form a story. That's an easy part. Checking the Bible verses, you know, when you hear, when I'm saying certain things, when certain things which are unheard, when you hear that, it's easy for you to hear it. That's an easy part. You know what's difficult? I'll tell you what's difficult. To approach it with a readiness of mind. Ask Holy Spirit's help to help you understand what is happening. So we understood from Daniel, the basis set. Then we understood Russia and its team attacks. Then we understood why Russia and its team attack, because Israel's boundary is going to expand. And why is Israel's boundary is going to expand? Because of the covenant God established in Genesis 15. Look at the connection between Old Testament and New Testament. And people say, just read New Testament. So when you believe this, again, I'm re-repeating this slide. These points, in fact, you need to ask, you know, what is Bible saying about all these things? Find out what really is going on. So you and I live in a unique environment. To us, the word of the God is more available today than it was ever been available in the history of planet Earth. Search and do your own research. You're provided with advanced informations of all kinds. Seek Holy Spirit's help for it. You don't have to be a teacher in today's world to dominate others. Just take notes from this internet materials. Discuss with each other today. And let the Holy Spirit take over your sessions. Pray and start. So what are your action points? Ask, what is God calling you to do? Raise your bar. As I said in the last session, raise your bar. The second point, don't waste your time with those kind of friends, with those kind of videos, with those kind of pastors, with those kind of advisors. Don't waste your time. Raise your bar. Your bar is already set. The benchmark is set for your understanding. Don't go below it. Seek Holy Spirit's advice consistently. Now that requires a conscious commitment. Without that, it won't happen. And I encourage all of you to be activated in small Bible study groups where you are encouraged to ask questions and respond to his calling, because time is short. Before I end the session, I would say one thing. You know, all of us are on a growth curve of some kind. We repeat our errors and not learn from it. That's not progress. We repeat our errors, we learn from it and move ahead. That's progress. I leave you with this statement. You know, you and me are getting plunged into a time about which Bible speaks the most. It's a prophetical time in everybody's life, yours and mine, who are living on the earth today. How many of us are aware of this? I leave you with that. Oh, yes, I wanted to show you this too. This is funny. Can you see this rocket on the screens? You know, it's going up, exploding on its own and taking its own path. What if I say that there's a certain person who has, or a certain interview which was published in a newspaper in 2014, I'll show you the date and the year and the newspaper too. It was published that the God of Israel changes the pathway of the rockets automatically and our rockets don't go and hit Israel. And who said that? It was a terrorist on the screens. On the screens, guys. It was Jewish Telegraph, if you can see on the screens, Friday, July 18th, 2014. And the headlines was, "Their God changes the path of our rockets in midair," said a terrorist. Look at that rocket. Wow. That's how we started off. And who was this terrorist? He represented a group from Gaza, the current day Palestine. So all praises to God of Israel, who is ready to do anything for not only Israelites, but also for us. I leave you with that. I open the question and answer forum for everybody. Thank you very much.